Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome to Healing X Outreach Radio. I'm your host, Augustine Estacio. Excuse me. I have a little bit of a rough voice this morning. We're back. Last week we had a little bit of a glitch. We were supposed to have a retelecast of Daniel Wallace, who's a Greek scholar, and I apologize for that. Blog Talk has made a couple changes once again on their formatting and uploading of old programs, and so I've had to make an adjustment. I hope I've learned how to curtail with that adjustment. So we will actually be doing that rebroadcast of Greek scholar Daniel Wallace from Dallas Theological Seminary next Saturday. Next Saturday, we will be doing that rebroadcast. And then subsequently, we will also be doing, after that Saturday, a live broadcast, but it will be me covering what I consider, the top 10 fails of the New World Translation, particularly the Silver Sword New World Translation, as produced by the Jehovah's Witnesses Watchtower Bible and Track Society that they have. And so I will be doing that the following Saturday. And then we will be on with a special guest. And that special guest will be, I believe it's Carrie Anderson, whose Mormon roots go all the way back to Joseph Smith. I think her descendants was one of the people that was there for the third vision, or for the first vision of Joseph Smith. So she will be our guest. We'll have another retelecast after that with, I believe that's Callie Hickok, who was in the cult called the 2x2s. And so that'll be a retelecast. And then afterward, I will be doing possibly, I think, a live feed on YouTube, and I think it will be covering the Jehovah's Witnesses and the bodily resurrection. And then we will have Ralph Bricky, who we were supposed to have in January. We were scheduled it to March, so we will have him on in, I think, the third week of March. So We have a full schedule for the next, 6 weeks, and we'll see how things develop from there. But, I don't know what happened here. Today we have a debate, and that debate is looks like an icons debate, a debate on images. That is the veneration of images, whether it's biblical and ancient. And it's between Dr. Musharraf Hussein. He's an accomplished Islamic scholar, educator, author, and scientist. And you can learn more about him in detail and all his work at musharrafhussein.com. And the person who will be taking the positive position in that debate is our good old friend William Albridge, who has a BA in theology, member of the Catholic Apostolate, the Catholic Legate, and you can find out more about him on his YouTube page, which is GNR Head, I believe, youtube.com/GNR Head. And he also has a link on godtube.com and catholic-legate.com to learn more about William Albridge. Let me see if they are both on. Is this you, William?
Yes, it is. And I am with Musharraf.
Okay, all right, great. Just for purposes, of course, of reviewing the debate, just to let everybody know, our debates are formatted. We have 2 7-minute openings, 2 5-minute rebuttals, and we have 6 6-minute cross exams, 2 7-minute closings, and then we will take Q&A from the listeners. We do have a debate ring, and I'm looking for it right here on our studio page. This is the debate ring, and this is the ring we use so that it can indicate that the person needs to close. Their time is actually closing, and so usually we just ask them to just try to wrap it up as succinctly as possible. We don't want them to lose their train of thought, and that indicates that, of course, that their time is up. So, William, if you're taking the positive, I guess, are you opening or is Musharraf opening?
Yes, yeah, I believe I'll be opening because I'm taking the positive. Is that okay with you, Musharraf?
I'll be very delighted with that. Yes, come on.
Wonderful.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Wonderful.
Okay, so you can open anytime you want, and I will start the time.
Okay, I will begin now. Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm very happy to be here yet again with my good friend. And I do consider him a good friend, Musharraf Hussein. We've been in dialogue for quite some time now, and he's a very, very intelligent gentleman. And today, before I begin the debate, I pray that God enlighten us both and God open both of our hearts, open both of our minds, and guide us and really, really touch everybody's hearts who are listening to today's debate on a very, very important topic, whether or not the veneration of images, icons, statues is acceptable, and whether or not it was historical and ancient. And I will begin by quoting Exodus 20, which reads, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." After the Ten Commandments are handed down, after we hear that you shall not have any other gods, you shall not make for yourself a graven image, you have Exodus 20 telling us just what God meant by the ordinances that were handed down to Moses. The Lord said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, you have seen for yourselves that I spoke with you from heaven. You shall not make gods of silver alongside me, nor shall you make for yourself gods of gold." God spoke from heaven, handing down his commandments, and the commandments were clear. You shall not make gods of silver or gods of gold, no graven images that were to be worshipped. The Lord God was clear, though. As we will see later and as we will examine, the vision of Ezekiel, the holy place was adorned with images, carved images, statues, right in the midst of the altar of worship. Images were present in Ezekiel's vision. So why was this not idolatry? Because the historical teaching of the historical faith was absolutely clear. The Bible was clear. The condemnation was towards idolatry, not towards images in totality. Furthermore, in Exodus 32, we read that the sin of the people who scorned the Lord their God was that they received the gold at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool and made a molten calf. And they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt." Aaron said, "Let not the anger of my Lord burn hot. You know the people that they are set on evil, for they said to me, 'Make us gods who shall go before us.' As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And I said to them, "Let any who have gold take it off." And they gave it to me, and I threw it into the fire, and there out came this calf. Now let us carefully examine what the idolatrous Israelites said to Aaron. "These are your gods." The calf credited as their god. They gave credit to this idol for taking them out of Egypt. Aaron committed the sin of idolatry, the grave sin of giving in and molding the gold into the idol. The reason that God condemned them was because the people of God had made the graven image of this calf into a god. They had broken the commandment handed down in Exodus 23. They had made a false god. They bowed to it. They gave latria to this calf. Ancient Christianity does not do what these Israelites were condemned for doing, nor does ancient Judaism. No divinity is given to any image, as the church is clear that that is idolatry. In fact, there is a term used by Christians, those of ancient persuasion, which is called dulia, which is honor and service. But that is not given to images either. Rather, that goes towards the saint that the image represents. And as Musharraf agreed with me when we were having our debate on Mary, veneration is proper to give to an individual in close proximity to the Lord. The Catholic Church does not teach that statuary, our God, is God, as the Israelites did with their golden calf. In fact, early Judaism, early Christianity, and later Judaism, they knew what the difference was between idols and images used in religious settings. And unfortunately, in my opinion, the idea that Muhammad adopted from previous dissenters of the faith was not a new one. In fact, the idea that he took from the previous dissenters wasn't new. The iconoclastic mentality has always been an erroneous one, but it didn't find its origin in Islam. It actually originated beforehand. You don't find that mentality in Josephus. You don't find it in the Maccabean texts or anywhere. The Talmud spoke of a tradition about ancient coins. Sculpted images were on them. The Journal of the Palestine Oriental Society, volume 15, tells us that the rabbis taught, what is the coin of Jerusalem? David and Solomon on one side, and Jerusalem, the holy city, on the other. The Jews talked about images, coins, with images in the Talmud and Midrash, and not once condemned them. It is the fact through historical examination that the Jews never adopted as normative a rigorous interpretation of the second commandment. The origin of the rejection of images, as all the fathers point out, has its origins in Gnosticism, Manichaeism, and it comes to a head in Islam. And it should have no place in one that holds the ancient and historical faith close to their hearts. Ezekiel 41 says, and he said to me, this is the most holy place. In front of the holy place was an altar. This is the table that stands before the Lord. And on the doors of the nave were carved angels, cherubim, and palm trees, carved on the walls. This all fits in with what the great John Damascus said when he quotes, when you see Christians adoring the cross, know that they are adoring the crucified cross, not crucified Christ, not the mere wood. The great Damascene was echoing the second century father Clement of Alexandria and the great Augustine, who in wrestling with the Manichaeans said, no one can shut their ears or eyes to the true faith, painted in so many places. And I will conclude my opening statement and give way to my very good friend Musharraf. I am very interested in hearing what he has to say about today's topic. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Hussain. You can begin with your time now.
Well, thank you very much, and good evening. And William, thank you for this invitation once more, and thank you for that prayer. You know, and I also reciprocate by praying to our mighty Lord that he guides us all on the path that will lead us closer to him. Give us his divine proximity so that we will be in his company and in the company of Christ, in the company of all those wonderful galaxy of prophets like Abraham, Moses, Muhammad, Noah, and so on. So thank you very much. And I'm also pleased that, you know, we begin on actually something that we agree. The Holy Quran and the Holy Bible both condemn in the harshest terms idolatry and its absurdity, its baseless and superstitious practices that are unforgivable. So that we agree on, how evil and vicious idolatry is. And what we mean by idolatry, I'm sure we agree on this as well. It's the worship of something or someone other than the one true God, the Almighty, the Creator, the Fashioner, the Guide, the Loving Lord and Maker of this vast and beautiful universe, and who takes care of us all the time. So it's really anything and anyone who we regard worthy of worship other than God, that is idolatry. So we would agree on that definition. Secondly, you know, I just want to point out this. What is the role of the religion? Well, first and foremost, it is to guide its followers, not just to provide information, knowledge, and facts and data and stories and histories, but actually to provide them knowledge that will help to solve their problems. The nation that Lord Almighty wants them to reach, the paradise, the heavens. And in order to get to that destination, it doesn't just provide, well, this is the straight way. It doesn't just show it, and God doesn't just take you, hold your hand and take you to it. In fact, he also, in addition to giving that and giving instructions, very clear instructions, how you can get to that and the way to it, he also actually gives us preventative measures, things that can actually distract us from it, things that can actually prevent us from reaching that wonderful destination, that final place that we all want to be in the company of our Lord Almighty and in the company of those wonderful people. So it provides preventative measures. And I think this is really important when we talk about icon, cause, as we said, idolatry is one of the worst, and you've given some beautiful quotes from the Bible where, you know, Bible harshly and, you know, categorically condemns idolatry as the most vicious form of living, really. It does not. It is materialism, where you love the material things rather than the Lord. So, yes, you mentioned all those, you know, the Chronicles, the Exodus, and all those. Let me just give you one or two quotes from the Quran, which also condemn idolatry. And I think that lays a very good foundation for us to then talk about icons. The Quran, for example, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, or Surah, verse 47 says, "You have received the book. Believe in what we revealed. It confirms what you already have. Before we turn your faces back to front, or else we curse you as we curse the people of the Sabbath." Here, you know, God is talking about, you know, you've received the book. You've got the guidance already there. And this book, the Quran, also confirms. But if you turn away from this, you know, God will turn your faces back to front. In other words, you know, he's going to break your neck. It's as simple as that. And he's going to curse you. He's going to curse, meaning simply that he's going to deprive you of his benevolence and his kindness. God's command is always fulfilled. God does not forgive those who associate anything with him. So this is the, you know, idolatry, associating anything with him. But he forgives anything less than that for whomever he pleases. So sins, no matter how big they are, major sins, other than idolatry, are forgivable. But idolatry is unforgivable, yet according to the majestic Quran. And in another place, you know, the Quran says, why this is? The idolaters will say, if God wanted, neither we nor our ancestors would have associated anything with God, nor would we have forbidden the eating of anything. In the same way, people before them used to lie outrageously until they tasted our punishment. Say, have you got any knowledge? Have you got any proof? Produce it for us. You do nothing but follow speculation and you tell lies. So here again, you know, the Quran is really telling us that the idolatrous practices nations have, the pagans had, the hedonists had, and the Romans and the Greeks had, not all of them, but many of them, and some, of course, Israelites followed that. You know, God is saying, well, they are condemnable. We will not allow this. God has conclusive proof. Who, if he had wished, could guide you all? Say, bring your witnesses who will testify that God forbade this. Even if they testify, you do not testify with them. Do not follow the desires of the deniers of our signs and the ones who do not believe in the hereafter, and hold others up as equals to their Lord. So those who hold others equal to their Lord are being condemned harshly here. And as you can see, the tone is very, very harsh and very similar to what the Bible has. There's no difference in that tone, in harshness against idolatry. I think I'll stop here just to emphasize the fact that the role of religion is not to just give instructions, but also to tell us what are the preventatives. And in fact, you know, if you look at the Ten Commandments, they're actually, oh, don't do this, don't do this, don't make the images of your Lord, believe in one God, worship one God, and don't do idolatry, are again those preventative measures. And I think that has to be respected. And I'll stop here.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Hussain, for your opening statement. We will go into the rebuttal period. And so we have 2 5-minute rebuttals. And William, you can begin with your 5-minute rebuttal.
Fantastic. I will begin now then. Okay, great. Thank you very much for that. To start off on a positive note in this rebuttal, it is very refreshing to see that Musharraf and myself agree wholeheartedly as to what we agree, what Latria is. And Latria is worship that is to be directed only to God, not primarily to God, but only to the one true God. In other words, we aren't supposed to give latria primarily to God and then a little bit of latria to a saint or high figure. No, all of it is meant to be given to God, and we agree on that. The Bible harshly condemns idolatry. Musharraf is very correct on that, but just as strongly as it condemns idolatry, it strongly emphasizes the proper usage of images in religious contexts. We were told what certain surahs said, and in a large context, surprisingly, we can agree with what is being said there. All religious worship, religious veneration, all of it is supposed to ultimately point towards God. And that is what the great Basil the Great from the 4th century said. All religious veneration, it goes to the prototype. It is supposed to ultimately go to God, whom you are supposed to be worshiping. I would remind the listeners about Ezekiel 41. We will definitely talk more about Ezekiel's vision. But remember that this vision is so important to our discussion today, because whereas idolatry is very, very strongly condemned, the proper usage of images, the proper usage of statues, we can find that in the historical text. The vision tells us, and I want to remind the audience, the usage in the Septuagint text of most holy place, those three particular Greek words, when combined together, they don't appear many times in the Old Testament. I found, at least on my end, about three instances. And out of those three instances, two of those instances were in reference to imagery in a holy place. For instance, Ezekiel's imagery is in the most holy place. The holy place was an altar, we're told. The table stands before the Lord. Verse 25, remember what this says. On the doors of the nave were carved cherubim. What are cherubim? They're angels. From God's heavenly court and palm trees, they were carved on the walls. The Greek term used there, I believe it's geglumena. I haven't researched that word in so many years, but I remember particularly, what does that Greek term mean? That means that these angels were carved. They were carved in this vision. And the vision wasn't simply just a dream that was later condemned. This was a vision of the idealized temple shown to Ezekiel, as Gregory the Great said, by an angel of the Lord. We were told that these were made that these commandments, I guess if you will, these ordinances in the holy, in what Musharraf would call his holy Quran, these ordinances were made to guide people towards God. And I can see that. I understand. But we have to be clear that these images, these statues, are not God. And if used in a proper context, that is wholly acceptable. Remember what today's dialogue is about. Is this historical? Is it ancient? And if we look at what the great John of Damascus said, he wrote a whole discourse talking about images, talking about icons, and one particular thing he is echoing. He's echoing the great second century. Listen to that. Second century father, Clement of Alexandria, who talks about images that represent Jesus Christ and the faith. They were engraved on seals. They were part of the faith. What is clear is that this was the faith that Christ left the church. So whatever we can see in Gnosticism, in Manichaeism, in certain portions of Islam, whatever we can see there, we must put this up against the pedigree of ancient history. Does it stand up to the test of the faith that was left to us by the Messiah? And my argument is that it doesn't. And that would be it for my my rebuttal period. I look forward to hearing what my good friend Musharraf has to say.
Well, William, you are giving me evidence and quotations from John of Damascus. Yet, we have the Bible. We have the Holy Scripture harshly condemning images and statues and making statues, you know, the golden calf that the Israelites made, how that was condemned by God in the harshest term. You read that from Exodus. And how David was told to destroy those statues. And yet you give me evidence from John of Damascus. What does he occupy? What position does he occupy compared to the Holy Bible? So I think, you know, you really do need to think about your sources of the evidence. You keep on speculating. You keep on giving third level of evidence. I'm presenting you first level evidence, which is the Holy Scriptures. Now tell me which is more valuable, the Holy Scriptures or the sayings of your wonderful saints? You know, and I think this is very important. Now let me just go back to, you know, what's wrong with icons? What's wrong with statues and painting? Well, I'll tell you what it is. Look how beautiful was Christ. Can you imagine those beautiful black locks of his, beautiful nose, those bright eyes of his? What a beautiful fragrance he had. What a beautiful physique God had given him. Which painter can ever capture that beauty in his rotten, two-dimensional oil on canvas? Capture that beauty on two-dimensional of a four-dimensional personality, eh? A personality who had not five senses, but six senses. A personality that radiated brilliance. Don't you think you're reducing him to such a low level by making paintings of him? And even worse, when you make a statue of such a great thing, I hope you can see the poverty of statues, the poverty of painting, the poverty of making drawings and depicting such holy figures into those rotten and ugly-looking clay or even marble pictures. I hope you can see the poverty of it. Why do you want to reduce someone as beautiful as Mary into such a rotten images that no wonder if it's Michelangelo or whoever it is, no one can depict that. So I think you really, you know, you've got to really be very serious about this here. You know, and you keep on talking about proper usage of icons. I'll tell you that, you know, human condition is such, there is no proper usage of statues and icons. That line between what is right and wrong, between icons and idolatry, I'll tell you, it is a very dangerous one. And I think on most occasions, human beings cross that and go into idolatry. So when you've got a church full of icons, left, right, center, back and front and up and down, and even on the floor, my goodness, what are you making your worshippers do? How much of God is there? Now, they've taken God away. Christ is no longer there. It's these rotten, red-colored, brightly colored, two-dimensional pictures rather than that wonderful Christ. It's a big distraction that distracts us from our Almighty Lord. That is why icons, statues are not allowed. I'll stop here.
Okay. Looks like I guess we can start with our cross-exam period a little early. And I guess that means, William, you have the first cross-exam, and you have 6 minutes in your cross-exam.
Great. Let me go ahead and begin now. Thank you very much for that, Musharraf. I want to go straight into what you said. You say the Bible condemns images and making statues. I have a question for you, Musharraf. Were images used in Ezekiel 41 condemned?
Well, come on. What is the second commandment? You will not make images of your Lord. What else? And look at those quotes he gave from Exodus of that calf, and the quotes from Chronicles about what wonderful David says. Very clear. I think that I'm really, it's all clear and cut, and you know, you can't deny that. No,
right.
There is no doubt.
I agree. I agree with what I read in Exodus, in Chronicles, with the condemnation of idolatry. But hold on.
Idolatry was what? Statues. They were the poles. They were the physical representations they had. That was destroyed. Isn't that enough to tell us what was the real cause of that idolatry? The images.
I don't agree. Yeah. But I want to go right back to the question that I was asking you. We can agree. I agree. We're on the same page when it comes to Exodus. When it comes to Chronicles. Excuse me. But I think we might be talking past each other a little bit. I agree these were physical representations. Unfortunately, I disagree that that's all they were. I believe these people had turned them into their gods. So my question to you goes right back to Ezekiel 41, not to Exodus, not to Chronicles, but in Ezekiel 41, were the images, were the statues in this temple, in this church, were they condemned?
Well, all I can say is statues, Christ did not like them. The Jews and the Israelites didn't like them. God doesn't like them. The Bible as a whole does not like them. Therefore, I'm not clear about your, the particular quotation you citing here from Ezekiel. But I think the whole spirit, And even the literally, it's very clear where statues stand in the Bible is condemnable.
Yeah, I'll use part of my opening statement to briefly read what Exodus says. It talks about the most holy place. It says that in this most holy place there was an altar. Then it says on the doors and the inside were carved angels, cherubim. They were carved in the walls. So we have statues in this location. My question is, let me ask the question first. Hold on. So my question goes right back to this. In this idealized vision of the temple, are these images, are these statues condemned, or are they acceptable?
Okay. Well, let's just think about this. You know what it's saying? This is the dream, the vision of the prophet, okay? And it's not actually saying that these will be the statues in there. It's talking about the angels coming into the temple, which makes far more sense than having marble or a steel or titanium or a platinum or a gold statues. So I think you've got to remember this prophet is having a vision. He's not saying that this is in the vision there is this, that. And those are not about statues. I don't think that's about statues. He's having a vision that the angels will be there in the temple glorifying the mighty Lord.
No, there's no argument. We agree that angels glorify the almighty Lord. But remember, this is not a dream. This is a vision that is being had. This an actual angel comes down and shows Ezekiel the idealized image of the temple. So I understand.
Shows him exactly. Idealized. Image. That is
right.
In his mind, of course.
Okay, so going, it's a vision. It's not said that he didn't imagine it. So whether it was a dream, a vision, or anything, are the images in this church condemned? Yes or no? Are they condemned or are they acceptable?
These are not, I'm not actually buying into this whole idea that that the prophet is having a vision where these will be statues or as such. They are going to be, even if they're images, you know, that does not, it's not actually, it's about, listen, angels are not going to be put into images. You can't put them into images anyway. They're a spiritual light energy, okay? So it's not really, I think it's that interpretation which has gone wrong somewhere and in the translation. But no, I don't accept this whole notion. No, I wouldn't accept that. So God would be, on the one hand, you see, this is a very big contradiction in the Bible then. On the one hand, the Bible is condemning statues. On the other, it's saying, no, it's okay. No, that would be contradiction.
But wouldn't you agree, Musharraf, that if the Bible shows that statues, when used as idols, are condemnable, but then if the Bible says they're acceptable if used in a proper manner, wouldn't you say then that the Bible is not contradicting itself?
Oh, wow. This is,
though,
it is, but I'll tell you how it is, because there is no proper use of idols other than what is idol. An idol is something that you regard as very important, and it's distracting you from the real God. And
so do you believe the text in Ezekiel? Do you believe that the text in Ezekiel is corrupted, maybe?
You know, I mean, the way you're interpreting it, certainly I would take it as that. Yes, certainly, yes. In that sense, I would take it, yes. Sorry, is that your
call? Okay,
No, that's the timer. It's going to be your turn now.
Oh, all right, okay, sorry.
Yeah, Dr. Hussein, you can have now your cross-exam. So you can go ahead and cross-exam William.
All right, yes, I've actually done that in some ways, yeah. Now, you know, let's just go back to the basics. I think we really do need to see, why does God regard idolatry so bad and icons? You see, I think our Christian friends do need to realize that you've had this battle going on between the iconoclasts and the iconophiles, those who love icons and venerate them, and those who actually condemn them and reject them. In other words, the Protestants and the Catholics. I mean, this is a, and even before the clash, there were, and of course we know that Leo III was one of the biggest iconoclasts who hated and removed the
Okay, let me just answer that right away. That's not correct. The so-called translation of Leo removing statues, that is an interpolation. That is not correct. Leo did not remove statues, but that is not correct. But going right back to the point, I do want to point one thing out. I don't know if you do live in Europe. I don't know if you've traveled to Germany. But a lot of these Reformation-era churches, I'll point to one in particular in Nuremberg, a lot of these churches have statues in them. A lot of the historical Reformation churches have statues in them. So really, if I'm going to be quite honest, I don't think the first iconoclast, if you will, to the Christians were the Protestants. It actually, I think a lot of Protestants or evangelicals would agree with proper usage of.
Well, I think you are trying to reduce the big arguments and the conflict and in fact fighting that
well,
went
no,
on
no,
between
I'm,
the iconoclasts
hold on
and
I'm
the iconophiles.
Right, I'm not trying to reduce it because I understand.
I think
the argument.
For nearly two centuries in the. In the Babylonian, in Babylon, they had this, and then, so you've had a very, very severe, and of course, Reformation was also, culmination of that as well, in many ways.
Well, if you look at what Luther said,
let's not minimize the enormous controversy and fighting that went on because of this, and I think of course, our Christian friends. From very early on, understood this. Where do we draw this line? That icons don't become gods, and the statues are not worshipped. It is such a difficult thing for ordinary folks, and therefore the best thing is prevent. When we have
let me comment on that briefly.
Can I just about something about prevention? It's so important part of any religion. In fact, your Ten Commandments are all about prevention of wrong things.
But
they stop from the worship of God. And similarly, believing in icons, statues, is not really venerating the saints or venerating the good thing.
Okay.
It is actually disrespect to them as well as disrespect, of course, blasphemy of God, in fact. And I think it's
okay. Let me go ahead and I'll take that as a question. First off, I'm going to touch upon what you said first in mention to Protestantism. I'm not trying to minimize the problems that early Protestantism had with Catholicism, but I would direct anybody interested in looking at the early controversies to look up the 95 Theses. Luther never once mentions images, never once mentions statues even once. So the origin of the problem was not statues and images. Rather, it at the heart of the issue was justification or indulgences at the heart, not images. So we can find an issue with images, Musharraf, at the earliest inception in Gnosticism, which was condemned in the Bible. Then you can find it in Manichaeism. And then, of course, as you know, in the faith that you hold near and dear to your heart. But I disagree with the representation you're making. I agree idolatry is definitely to be condemned. But Musharraf, what did the ark have? What was the ark? There were cherubim on the ark. Those are angels, Musharraf. There's no way for you to argue yourself out of that. Those are angels. The image in Ezekiel, this isn't my interpretation. I said what the Greek says is geglumena. That means carved and most holy place. The Greek word used in the Septuagint is hagios. So we're told that this is the most holy place, and in the most holy place of this vision, not a dream, of this vision, was a church with images on the inside. So, remember, Musharraf, I agree with you. I read what Chronicles says. I read what Exodus says. Idols are condemned. Because what did Aaron say? Aaron said that they had made them into gods. So if you make an idol, if you make that into your god, if you worship that, if you give that latria, if you give that worship, that is idolatry. But nowhere were images condemned. In Ezekiel's temple, there were images there of statues of angels. Those weren't condemned. And the Ark of the Covenant, the cherubim on the Ark were not condemned. And these were carved by the hand of man. These were carved by the, as you said, the poor, the poverty-stricken hand of man, yet they were acceptable to the Lord God.
Well, let me ask you this, William. Did Jesus ever pay respect to any statue? Did he have any icon?
Jesus in Colossians is called an icon, not in the sense of being a statue, but no, we don't read to Christ, we don't read anything about Christ.
Hold on, what about the disciples? Jesus has nothing to do with idols. Let me tell you that for you. What about disciples?
Let me answer that question about, let me lump them both together for you, Musharraf. Jesus and the disciples. We never read about them talking about images or talking about icons. But here's the interesting thing, Musharraf. Jesus didn't need to talk about them. The apostles don't need to, because they're painted in a positive light in the Old Testament in many places.
Well, all right. You guys are flipping out. So, William, this is your cross-exam period, and you can begin now.
Okay, let me start off with a question that I've got for you, Musharraf. We both know that angels are part of God's court. Do you think that angels are beautiful?
Oh, I mean, I have no doubt. God makes everything beautiful. Yes, it would be amazing and beautiful. Yes.
Then why didn't Allah or Yahweh, if you will, condemn the usage of angels, God's holy angels, in the temple of Ezekiel and in the Ark of the Covenant, if, as you said, there is only poverty in statues?
Well, as I said to you, I don't actually believe that statues and images are being praised condoned.
Well, they're being utilized, but they're being utilized.
It is the real angels who would be actually there. The real angels, the presence of the real angels. I mean, that is what is what makes it holy and spiritual, the temple, not the stone or concrete or even marble or gold angels.
I don't believe that there is anything holy in.
And who's seen angels? Who would be able to draw it? Who's seen an angel? How would he ever depict them?
Excuse me. Yeah, I don't believe the actual statuary itself is holy. But the question is a very important one, Mushanab, because you made a statement a little while ago saying that there was only poverty in statues, which means that there is nothing of significance there. So you agree with me that angels are beautiful. You just agreed. So if that is the case, and if there is only poverty in statues, then why didn't Allah condemn the usage of these holy angels when they're used in the positive connotations?
I think, you know, the premise of your question is not something I accept. That I don't accept about the statues as such. But let's, you know, I think we really do need to concentrate on the purpose of Christianity and of any religion, Islam or Judaism, is really to help its followers to get close to the Almighty.
Yes,
I
agree.
These
completely.
Things become, these become big distractions. As I said to you, they are actually very poor. And furthermore, you know, can you just imagine? These are really artists, you know, who are just filling their own desires and their own.
Mushanab, what if, I'm going to pose an interesting question. What if, and this is hypothetical, what if there's a church in 3rd century Alexandria where the bishop, it's a poor church, it's in persecution, and the whole congregation are illiterate. Wouldn't you agree that those images, those statues that perhaps show the great God of the Old Testament, show the God of the Old Testament in images, wouldn't you agree that that can be used in a proper context for people that perhaps were illiterate, that could guide them towards a better understanding? Is
okay,
that not
possible? I would not. I think that would be very, very dangerous. I mean, that bishop or that priest would be making a very, very serious mistake, because he's drawing his congregation towards idolatry and saying, you know, and he's diminishing and he's reducing the mighty Lord into this thing. He's reducing the beauty of Christ and the power of Christ into this two-dimensional rotten stone or paper or what.
Were the angels reduced to something rotting?
Well, I don't accept that. I'm not accepting that, you know, that premise. I'm not accepting. So we really can't talk about it.
I accept that. I'll just say
I cannot see that God would be. Mm-hmm.
I would recommend that you do look up that text in Ezekiel 41. Look it up. Go to the oldest text, the oldest manuscripts, and I hope you look at that. But anyway, let me move on to another question. And I'm going to move past Ezekiel 41. Can you name any Jewish historian, any early one, post-biblical era, any early Christian, any of them, Musharraf, that condemned the usage of images in a proper in a religious context?
You know, you had almost two centuries between the the 7th and the 9th century of
Josephus. Well, we've got Josephus, though.
I'm not familiar with your scholars, but all I know is for two centuries.
He's a Jew. He is a Jewish. He's not a Christian scholar. So if you want to look at the text of the Maccabees or Josephus, remember, Josephus is not a Christian.
I'm not too interested in individual scholars. And I think for me, and you as well, William, the Bible and the scripture is far more important than any Jewish or any Christian scholar or a Muslim scholar for that thing. I know God's words are far more powerful.
Yes,
than
but wouldn't
these, this is the other thing, you see. This is where, again, these saints can become idols for us as well. And they can become a great blockage between us and God. And therefore, we have to be very careful. And I think this is where Christian Reformation was so important for the Christians.
Let me make one point. I agree. But let me just make a clear point. Josephus is not a figure that I venerate. I don't know any Christian that would. He was Jewish. He was not Christian. I agree. The Bible should be the main source. I agree with you right now, Musharraf. But here is the problem. If the belief that images in totality were idolatry, we've got to have some proof, Musharraf. post-biblical era where this teaching continued, and you can't show me anyone.
Well, let's first of all see when did these come in. We know that.
It's going to be your turn now. It'll be your turn now to cross-examine me.
Let me just continue with Dr. Hussein's cross-examine.
Okay, let me just continue with what you've finished with, William, which is that, you know, the Christians, of course, began to use the fish as one of their icons. And then in the 3rd century, the crucifix became... But that was in the 3rd century. You know, you already see there's a big gap between the original Christians and the third century. And then you had a big battle going on and a conflict amongst the Christians. Isn't that enough to give you, wake you up that, look, you know, something was desperately wrong? It was only the emperors who wanted their vanity and to show that they too were godly and godlike, that they began to use icons.
Let me answer that for you. You're very wrong, not just with your, and I know you're referring to Emperor Constantine. You're not just wrong, you're very wrong, because images predate Constantine. If we look at what Eusebius and Epiphanius say, images, even statues of Christ already existed, predated that, Musharraf. We know that there was a church that it no longer stands, but Indira Europos was an old, ancient church that well predated anything that Emperor and let me add one thing. We don't even have historical evidence that Constantine asked them to make any images or statues. There's no evidence of that. But I'll tell you what there is evidence of, Musharraf. There's evidence that the Old Testament talks about images in a positive manner, statues. And there's evidence that the earliest Jews do and the earliest Christians. So I don't agree with your dates. I think that they're way off. And I know you're probably going to be quoting certain scholars. But one thing that we have to remember, Musharraf, is that everybody has their own scholar. What is important is firsthand source material. Not what some scholar says, because I can say, well, guess what, Musharraf, my scholar said this and that, and you can say, well, mine said this. What is the meat and potatoes has got to be firsthand source material, and I can provide much of it that talks about images used in a positive manner.
Well, I mean, all I can see, and I think what many, many Christians also believed and adopted, was that this is a very dangerous, slippery slope of icons, because if you walk on this, I mean, the Quran gives an example. It says an example of those who adopt gods beside God is like a spider that spins a web, and a spider's web is the weakest of any whom, if only they knew. God knows what they call on beside him is nothing. He is the Almighty, the Wise. So I think really, you know, we need to be very wary of anything that slips us into that mode where we forget the mightiness of God, the greatness of God.
I think your point is very important, that you're right. We have got to be careful. But I'm going to be honest with you, Musharraf. I've traveled to so many places. I've talked to Christians, to Catholic Christians in Mexico, in Germany, even in Britain, in so many places. And you know, Musharraf, I've never ever met one Christian that shows me a statue of Mary or Jesus or an angel. I've never met one that shows me a statue and says, that is my God. I've never met one, Musharraf. Rather, I've only met them that tell me this helps bring me closer to the Almighty God, because I adore only God, but I venerate the beauty of his creation. So I think that there must be a clear distinction made. And I'll just add one more thing, and I think this is important for us to remember, Musharraf. There aren't any early Jews, there aren't any early Christians outside, because we disagree in the Bible. We can disagree on what the Bible says morning to night. But if we look at the historical pedigree of the very first Jews, the very first Christians, I believe that you will not be able to show me even one that utilized images that believed that they were gods or became gods.
Well, I'm a scientist, and we believe that, for example, you know, high blood pressure and heart diseases and stroke are a result of atherosclerosis. And atherosclerosis in the arteries, hardening of the arteries, is a result of eating too fatty, too salty, too sugary foods. Now, therefore, the preventative measure is reduce your fat, reduce your sugar, reduce your, the salts. And, we've got to prevent people from idolatry, from materialism. And idolatry and materialism are so closely intertwined that, we now in the West have the most materialist society ever in the history of humanity. And I think if religion and our places of worship begin to go down that lane of materialism and icons, I can see a very, very dangerous. And we're already seeing it. I think it's a slippery slope. That is why religion prevents us from going down that lane. When the human mind is so powerful, the image you can have of God in your mind is so great and so beautiful. Why do you have to put it into that rotten marble or even gold or titanium? That is where our intellect and reasoning and creativity lies. It is to be combined, not reduce God into ugly form.
Let me answer that for you, because as Gregory the Great, when Gregory was reading and commenting on what Ezekiel 41 says, as Gregory the Great said, this idealized temple vision, these angels, these images are not viewed as being ugly by these individuals. Rather, it's the best an artist can put to give honor to God to the best of their capacity. Okay, that's it for that period. I believe it's my final cross exam now, I think.
I think this is your cross exam now, William.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah.
Musharraf, you made the claim. You made the claim that Christianity, in their usage of images, had copied the pagans. And when we were debating on the topic of Mary, when we were dialoguing, you did make one example, and the example you used was Isis. Do you believe that the Christians copied the statue of Mary and basically copied that from paganism?
I think, there's no doubt about it that Romans and the Greeks were very, very into these kind of forms. They were very, very keen, and they loved that sort of thing. And they wanted to bring that into, they wrote it into Christianity. No doubt about it. No doubt.
Are you aware, Musharraf, are you aware that the earliest image of Mary with the baby Jesus in the nativity scene dates to the 200s, but the earliest image of what you claimed, what you said in our previous dialogue of Isis with her baby, that actually dates to the 4th century. So wouldn't that logically in turn show that, as Justin Martyr said, the pagans were actually copying what was becoming the normative in the religion of Christianity?
Well, can I just say this? Why do you want to draw the beautiful Christ in such a rotten form and shape, and Mary the beautiful and virgin in every sense, multidimensional, and why do you want to reduce them? That is why, I just cannot understand why honorable, dignified people are reduced to two-dimensional, rotten images.
Well, because let me try to phrase that in a question. Let me actually phrase the question and ask you a question. Remember what Ezekiel says in a vision in the chapter 41, what Exodus says about the Ark of the Covenant. And I never, ever see that those images are called rotten or ugly or hideous. But wouldn't you agree, Musharraf, that nobody is trying to reduce those statues of angels to mere marble or mere statuary? They're not trying to reduce them or take away their beauty. Rather, they're trying to give honor to God by representing them in the best way that they can in their limited human capacity. Would you agree with that?
Well, I'll agree to disagree. Yes, I will agree to disagree. That is, God is so mighty and beautiful that to do this, I would obviously regard that as sacrilegious and dishonor to him, because he deserves far more. We just cannot And that
you
is why
the
commandment
Bible
says, don't
do
intimidate the Lord.
Yes, but I mean, let me use the final 3 minutes of my cross-text to make this a little bit more free-flowing. You can see, though, Musharraf, in Ezekiel, not just Ezekiel, in Exodus, and what I call the earliest philosophers, Jewish writers and Christian writers, I mean, you can clearly see that the usage of images was acceptable in a proper context. So how can you logically dispute that it is possible to use? I mean, remember what this says, Musharraf. The oldest manuscripts that exist, they call this the most holy place, Hagias, and these are filled with images. I mean, how can you reconcile that with the idea that, well, images are ugly, they're horrible, and they are just idols, if the Old Testament text does not call all images idols?
Well, as I said, there is a huge contradiction between if Ezekiel is talking about statues, then there's a huge contradiction between other parts of the Bible and this, and that in itself is a big fault. I don't believe it is like
that.
I believe about real angels in the real temple, living angels, those lights and those beautiful real things. Why would Allah want? Why would God want to have marbles and rotten clay there when He can have beautiful light illuminated angels in His temple?
Yeah, maybe we disagree on perhaps the New Testament, but are you trying to say that perhaps the Old Testament is that it contradicts itself? Do you believe that the Old Testament
in places? Okay. Yes, you've just given an example. I think if what you are saying is correct in Ezekiel,
then this is
a classic example of that contradiction.
Well, if you believe that the Old Testament contradicts itself and that all images were basically idols. I've asked you already more than once. I'll ask one more time. We may disagree on what the Old Testament says, but where in history, Musharraf, predating Muhammad, before Muhammad, where are the Christians? Where are the Jews that condemn the complete usage of images? Where are they? Can you name one for me?
I'm not a Christian historian, really. I'm.
Well, what about a Jew? Can you name a Jew? He's just one Jewish historian. I mean, there were more than one. You know, we've got Josephus, we've got a rabbi.
We don't base our religion on scholars or Jews or Christians or Muslims. We base it on the Book of God and the words of God and the teaching of God. You know, and I think that's a very fundamental point that we need to go to.
We do too. I don't believe these historians are. I don't believe they're inspired, but I believe that they provide evidence. And we don't believe they're inspired, but if we can point to some, we can show that this pedigree is ancient and does date back to a previous era. So that's pretty much the reason why I've asked you several times if you can name just one Jewish historian or one Christian, but you have not been able to provide.
No, I don't know. Let me be honest. I don't know Christian. All I know is the icon. There have been iconoclasts from the very beginning in Christian.
All right, so this will be the last cross examine. It'll be Dr. Hussein with the closing cross examine, and then we'll have a closing statement.
Well, you know, the what I see very clearly here from Williams is that. Williams believes that icons can help people to worship God better and support them in that.
Let me answer that for you, because remember, this is your final cross exam. So let me, before we close, it's not closing yet. Let me answer that for you. I want to confirm for the listening audience. I don't think images are necessary to worship God. But the argument made is that I believe images can be used in a proper context, in a religious context that is acceptable. And you made a comment in the closing period of my cross-ex where you said that from the very beginning, there were Christian iconoclasts. Well, I'm going to answer that for you. Where are they? I can't ask you that, but
look at the evangelists in Europe, Henry VIII. You want to know iconoclast?
Well, that's not early. That's very late. I mean, if we're going to talk about a very late time period, then we can talk about all sorts of different beliefs that have popped up, Musharraf. But remember, ancient historical argumentation must have pedigree. And if you're saying from the very start, then to be quite honest with you, I'm not interested in individuals that pop up in the Middle Ages or in the Reformation era. I want to know about the people that were closest to the time of Christ, what Thomas Aquinas called that golden chain that went all the way to the apostles, people that were taught and trained by them, Irenaeus, who knew John, Musharraf, people like that. I want to know what the earliest people believed. And if you're telling me the earliest Christians were iconoclasts, then really, to be quite honest, I need to hear at least one of them. And you haven't provided the name of even one.
Okay. I'm looking at the very spirit of the whole of Christianity and of Islam. The spirit is that we become godlike, we become godly, we become God-focused, and we are not distracted by anything. The whole point of having a house of worship where we are removed from all distractions, and then to have icons there, statues there, pictures there, which distract us from having link and connection with the Almighty, I think really defeats the whole object of worship. And so that is why we would not allow, these icons and these paintings.
And that would be the complete opposite, though, Musharraf, for an early Jew or for a Christian. Because remember, and I know it's almost as if I've mentioned it a million times, I imagine the listening audience are going to have Ezekiel 41 burnt into their mind. But remember what the Bible, the Old Testament, says. If you want to say it's contradictory, fine, we'll use it as a historical reference. If we look at what the oldest manuscripts of what is purported to be Ezekiel 41, what they say, this is called the most holy place. The Greek term uses hagios for a place that is holy. We know that God will dwell here. There's the altar of the Lord there. There are sacred and religious images aplenty. Yet today, as you have told me, the images are prohibited in Islam. So I know I can't ask the question, but I'm just going to say, I just can't understand why there is such a huge disconnect with ancient Judaism, ancient Christianity, and what you're telling me is the belief in Islam, if really in the early period this wasn't present.
Well, I think, this is where we'll have to sort of agree to disagree. I think as a Catholic, Williams, I know you're into icons and images are very fundamental to your, you believe they're going to help you and support you. And
I don't believe the help.
Why have something of that kind then? I can't really, I've been to lots of, of course, West is full of statues and images, and wherever you are, you find these statues. And I find them quite actually denigrating to humanity.
Because this is what I believe, Musharraf. I don't believe that a statue can help me. I believe that, as Revelation says, that the communion of saints, the body of Christ, those alive on earth, those in heaven, as the image in Revelation 5:8 and 5:13 say, I believe that we're connected in the body of Christ. We can intercede for one another. You agreed with me that intercession is present in Islam. So I believe in intercession, as Revelation shows that beautiful imagery. I don't believe any statue or image can intercede for me. But I believe, as Basil the Great says, that any honor to any image, to any statue, is for the prototype, for the representation of what is being presented there, Musharraf. I don't think any statue can perform any miracle for me.
I think, I said, the prototype is Christ. Prototype is Abraham. Prototype is Muhammad and Moses. And to have them represented in such forms, we would certainly regard as undignified and crude, hand-fisted, and a very reductionist attitude. And I think I'll end with that because I don't think we've got it. I'd love to have some questions, to be honest. Those are my closing remarks as well, because I don't want to drag this on any further, because it's really, you know, it's almost cyclical now. So I think that's, I would close with those remarks myself, William.
Okay. All right. So then.
Okay. I do want a closing, though. Is that okay if I get my closing?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We have our closing statements. And so, William, you have your closing, and then Dr. Hussein has his closing, and he'll have the final word for his closing statement. So you can begin your closing whenever you want.
Okay, I'll go ahead and I'll begin now. First off, I want people to know that before I even go into the closing statement, that Musharraf, even though we may greatly disagree in so many areas, Musharraf knows that I have great esteem for him. I consider him a very good friend. I love him as a friend, and I've reached out to him many times just to dialogue and talk. He's a great individual, but even though somebody you can respect somebody so much, it's a matter of respect to be able to tell the person that you think they're wrong. And I respect Musharraf so much as not just a scholar, but as a friend. And I'm honored to say he's a friend of mine, to be able to say that I think he's got it very wrong in this position. And I think he really, really, really needs to dig and really look at what does early history show us? I mean, I mentioned Ezekiel so much that I'm sure people probably already have it memorized. I talked about Exodus, Josephus, Clement of Alexandria, Augustine, Basil the Great. I mean, who are these individuals? I mean, we've got to remember Josephus, the early church fathers. None of these guys, none of them have the stature, the standing, the position of a great individual like Ezekiel would have. None of them. Ezekiel, that text is the word of God. And as a Christian, I believe that the word of God is inerrant. I don't think there is error in the word of God. And I think every jot and tittle of the original manuscripts are inerrant. And I believe the oldest manuscripts of Ezekiel 41 show us. They show us the vision from the angel of God, as Gregory the Great said, as the great venerable Bede said, the angel sent by God in Ezekiel 41 to show the idealized temple vision. In the most holy place, there were images, sacred and religious, plenty of them. Never do we read that these images were full of poverty, or that they denigrated God, or they brought God down. I mean, sure, they're not images of Christ or of God, but images, the angels were part of God's holy court. Angels, as Musharraf admitted, were beautiful. They are beautiful. And why didn't God condemn these statues of holy angels if they were simply idols? Because as I pointed out in Exodus, as I pointed out in Chronicles, as I pointed out on the usage of the cherubim on the ark, it was acceptable for images to be used in a religious context outside of the realm of idolatry. Why would God allow something carved by the hand of a man, the dirty hands of men? If you think your hands are dirty, imagine the people, the carpenters, imagine the people whose hands existed back then. They must have been filthy beyond belief. Why would they be allowed to carve something? And then we're told that this is the most holy place, this temple. There's a disconnect somewhere. And I can tell you positively the disconnect is not with ancient Judaism and ancient Christianity. These beings, these angels were consonant. They are consonant with worship and praise of God. Revelation 11:19 says that the prophet saw the temple in heaven open, and the ark of his covenant was seen in the temple. These beings are consonant with worship and praise of God. So why can we not have images? Why are the images and statues that we have idols if they were acceptable to the ancient Jews? Even to the Jews in the Maccabean period, we fast forward, hop into a time machine, even to the Maccabean period, they're acceptable. jump right back into that time machine, Josephus' time. They're acceptable. Go to the time of Clement of Alexandria. They're acceptable. But they're not acceptable in Gnosticism, in Manichaeism. They're not acceptable in Islam because we're told that they are idols. I think that there is a disconnect because Paul spent so much time battling and fighting against the ideology of Gnosticism. Tertullian, the great Ignatius of Antioch, spent so much time fighting against this idea that matter was evil, fighting against this idea that things were evil. What does Tertullian say? They're images of the Good Shepherd on the chalices. That means that the church, in its infancy, in its early stage of persecution, viewed images as being so important that they were on the chalices. There were plenty. Look up Dura Europos. Look up how frequent these images were in the earliest churches, in early Judaism. Images can become dangerous if one were to worship an image as an idol. But not all images are idols. And we can see that as shown in what Musharraf says is, should be our example, the holy text. And whereas we disagree, I respect Musharraf with all of my heart. I love him. And I will continue to tell him that I believe he's wrong and continue to have friendly and fruitful dialogues with him because I consider him a friend. And I will conclude my closing statement with that, and I want to wish the blessings of God upon our great moderator, Gus, and upon Musharraf. And I will give way. I am interested in hearing what he has to say in his closing statement. Thank you.
Dr. Hussein, you have your closing statement, and then we'll open up the lines for questions from the callers.
Well, William, thank you very much. And I'm really delighted to hear this again, that you are my friend and you love me as a human being. And I think that's a wonderful spirit. And I, too, have exactly the same sentiment that I love you as our fellow human being, the son of Adam and Eve, and someone who claims to follow the wonderful Christ as well. So thank you for those very positive remarks. Now, we believe that our job is really to first and foremost by the Lord, thank him for all that he has given us. And I think one thing he has given us, which is really very remarkable, is our intellect. It's our mind. It's our brain. It's our power of reasoning. It's power of creativity, planning, visioning, dreaming, and seeing. It is so powerful that there is no computer that can match it. And the visions that we can have and the visual images we can create in our mind are so vast and so great that to put those onto a canvas, to put them onto a stone or engrave them or etch them into the stone is not really possible. It really is a very reductionist attitude. And that is why, that's one reason why icons are out for us. Secondly, if you look at what has happened by following this attitude that icons are okay, look at what has happened to Hinduism, what has happened to Buddhism, what has happened to Shintoism, Confucianism, and what has happened to some of the other religions. That now all they do is image worship, whether it's a monkey or whether it's a cow, whether it is a whatever. It now has become reduced. This is what happens in humanity. This is a weakness in humanity, and God knew this well, that this is a weakness in humans. Therefore, we prevent those things that cause the disease. And therefore, I believe that icons were not allowed and images were not allowed in the true religion because they would eventually lead to those the dangerous consequences we are seeing around, in religions that now have become mythological and statue-worshipping religions, really. And finally, I think, idolatry, we've agreed on, is the most dangerous thing. Unforgivable, it is absurd, it is something which is baseless, and it is a superstitious practice. That is one of the key purposes of the teachings of Christ, the key purposes of the teaching of Muhammad, of all the prophets, that we've got to avoid idolatry. And I think anything that leads to idolatry, therefore, naturally, must be prevented and stopped. Just like, as I said, in order to stop your high blood pressure and heart diseases, you've got to stop those sugary foods and salty foods and so on. Similarly, we've got to prevent, you know, the wrong that might happen because of this. So in conclusion, you know, I would say let us use our brains rather than use Michelangelo or any of the great painters or whatever they are, you know, to help us come close to God. God is so mighty that he will embrace us anyway if we are sincere in his worship. With that, I'll end. Thank you.
Thank you. That was quick and short. So let me go ahead and let everybody know. The number is 347-934-0379. And press 1 if you have any questions to either of these gentlemen. 347-934-0379. If you don't, I have a whole host of questions. And so, you know,
William,
like I said,
I have to leave at 7:30. So I've only got 10 minutes left.
Yeah.
So please. Okay,
yeah, so we have plenty of time, but I do want to say a few things about this debate. Okay, when I scheduled this debate, and William told me what the debate was about, I wasn't really excited about the debate, and that you sometimes that's the case when William schedules a debate, and I'm like, oh, okay, ho ho hum, and then as the debate went on, I was like, wow, this is really. This is something really to talk about, and this is coming from three different perspectives because we have right here we have a William who's Catholic, even though he was a formerly Protestant. We have a Muslim here on the line, and then we have me who I began as an evangelical. I actually came out of an evangelical cult, and evangelicals have this same tendency to have this view about images and worship, and particularly those of the fundamentalist Protestant branch. But as an evangelical, I've evolved as a Christian. That is, I've probably grown a lot closer towards more ancient forms of Christianity, which means, of course, Orthodox, you know, Eastern Orthodoxy and Catholicism. And the earliest forms of evangelicalism, which we call mainline Protestants, actually have characteristics of the more ancient forms of Christianity, which is Orthodoxy and Catholicism.
Yes.
So I'm saying this to say that I have been on the perspective where I am combating William on this topic, and I'm still not quite there, but I understand the Catholic position, I understand the Greek Orthodox position, and I understand the context, and I think the context is what gets lost here. This is a discussion of the use of images as being biblical and ancient in the veneration of God, really, actually. First of all, let me go ahead and let this caller in, because I'm always going to let the callers get first dibs over myself, and then maybe we can begin with my train of thought later on. 916, you're on the air.
Hey, Augustine. Hey, William. This is Miles.
Hello, Miles, how are you,
wanted to,
my friend?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing well.
Thank you all for the excellent debate. This question is actually a two-part question for Dr. Hussein. The first part of it is, Dr. Hussein, do you ever pay attention to any of the context every single time that the Old Testament condemns the usage of images? It's always in the context of replacing the one true God with the images. It's not condemning the actual creation of them. It's because of what they were being used for. Question is, do you actually read the context? The second part is, I know you don't accept William's usage of Ezekiel, but aside from Ezekiel, all throughout the Old Testament, we see images being used in a proper way in worship. For example, in Numbers, Moses uses a bronze serpent. God commands Moses to create an image for the healing and condemnation of the people. And then probably the greatest example is in 1 Kings in chapter 6 and 7. Solomon, in building the temple, creates images all throughout the temple. And does God create it or condemn it? No. The glory cloud of God rests in the temple. So those are my questions for you. What do you do with First Kings 6 and 7, with all of the images that are used in the temple, and God's glory cloud rests in the temple, showing that he approves of it? And also, what about the context of every single time God condemns the idols? And those are my questions.
Well, you know, of course, contextualization is so important in scripture that without that, you will get a wrong interpretation and understanding of it. So no doubt that you have to take the context. But the context is absolutely clear that God does not like those images, those statues, whatever their reason. The biggest, they then become the barrier between God and humanity. We become materialistic. You know, you're a very intelligent person. Williams is a graduate from world-class country in education, America. So I think you've got to really understand that a lot of people will not take it in that way, and of course they don't. This, and as you said, they begin to use them as intercession. They begin to use them as mediators. They begin to pay attention to them rather than to God. And this is the beginning of materialism. This is what materialism is, you know, giving the material more importance. I don't know about the kings, to be honest. Those quotations you gave, I've not read them, so I can't make any comment. It'll be foolhardy of me to say that.
In 1 Kings chapter 6, verses 23 through 29, Solomon has cherubim, trees, and flowers made. And then in 1 Kings chapter 7, verses 25 through 45, he has bronze oxen, lions, and pomegranates made. And again, God does not condemn this because the glory cloud of God comes and rests in this temple, showing his
approval. Let me briefly comment. First off, I got to say, Miles, you have a great radio voice. You've got a great voice for radio, my friend. let me comment on what Miles has said. I think that goes right to the heart of the issue. when I was dialoguing in Mushabah, I believe I'm on the same exact page as Miles, and I'm sure Mushaf isn't surprised at that. The Bible, all throughout the Old Testament, Miles is correct. Images are used; they are utilized in a proper context, and the particular book of Kings is very important because, like Ezekiel 41, those Greek terms are used there, where we have images in the proximity of what is called in the Greek the most holy place. The Greek word used is hagias there. So that is where we have such a big disconnect. And I hope after this debate, Moshe does maybe go back and maybe examine those texts. And even if he comes to the conclusion that perhaps they have, as I have read Muslim scholars, that say perhaps the texts have been corrupted. Look at the oldest manuscripts that I believe show such a great pedigree of that historical chain that goes right to the very beginning, that shows that images used in a religious context are acceptable to God, to Almighty God.
I guess this will okay,
I've made my point many times before. I have, yes.
Dr. Hussein, you did say something during the debate that caught my attention. You mentioned, of course, the Christians using the Ithacus, that is the fish symbol. And I thought that was kind of an admission that Christians did use images, because you pointed out that they used the fish symbol. And, of course, they found in archaeological digs, for example, Pompeii, when the volcano had mm-hmm. had, you know, of course, unleashed its fury. There was, you know, churches, church homes, which had crosses in the church homes in the archaeological digs. So they were using crosses also. In the Bible, it says, for example, Paul says that, you know, he boasts only in the cross of Christ. And the fact that they were actually using crosses as images in their homes. But I think the key issue of this, of course, of this debate is, should such images be used in worship? And so that leads me to this one big question that I have for you as a Muslim is that, and this is why I also find it kind of interesting, because Muslims go pilgrimage to Mecca once a year, I guess, or at least once in their lifetime. And they go around the Kaaba, and then they prostrate themselves, don't they? So wouldn't the Kaaba be a violation of that, unless there's a context, for example, a context that the prostration is not towards the Kaaba, but towards Allah? So that's why this is important.
I think that's a very context. Very, very good question of yours. And the reply is this, that the Kaaba is a symbol, and we call it actually the house of God. Not that God lives in it, but just a representation as such. It's not you'll notice it's not animal representation. It's actually a symbol that could be which actually gives a location. It's about giving a location, actually. It's not about even a symbol or a representation in any form. It's really about giving a physical location, that this is the center, and you know you can face, you know, Muslims face from actually from the north, they'll be facing south, from the south they'll be facing north, from east to west, western east. So it's actually not Muslims never believe that we are actually worshipping the Kaaba whatsoever. It's not. It's just actually a physical symbol there. Yes.
Yeah, and I think that's exactly the same argument that ancient Catholics and the Orthodox would say, is that when they use images,
what we're saying.
It's a symbol. It's not that thing is actually God. And this is what actually kind of moved me. And this is why dialogue is important, because when you have dialogue, then you understand the context of each other's positions, and then you understand, wow, you know, what you just described is exactly what Catholics and Orthodox would say, you know, as far as their use of images. Of course, it's really, really difficult to see that when you see someone bowing or actually even kissing, for example, a picture of an ancient saint. But there's a context. Mm-hmm. There's a context to those things. Which is why, because of this debate, I want me and William to have a podcast on the discussion of this. To actually further this. Because Protestants actually miss out on that context, which you just described, in Muslims faithfully pilgrimaging to Mecca. And most, like from my background, evangelicals would say, look at those Muslims performing an idolatrous act, bowing to the Kaaba. But what you just said is that this is not an act of worship to the Kaaba. It's a symbol. And that is, this is a symbol that this is where God's presence is. This is the house of God. This is God manifestation here. He's present here in a special kind of way. And this is exactly what the Old Testament describes about the ancient tabernacle or the temple that Jesus went to for Jerusalem when he would pilgrimage to Jerusalem for Passover. You know, Jews go to Jerusalem. That is their Mecca. And Muslims go to Mecca. And so and Christians even still to this day go to Jerusalem. But I think that that's a great way to for us all to come to an understanding together. Let me go ahead and... there's 830, you're on the air.
Yes, hi. I have a question for William, and I want to ask, did Christians copy statues from the pagans? I'll listen off the air. Thank you.
Okay, that's a really good question, and we've heard it a lot. And I would direct the caller to, first off, before I answer it, look up a podcast that we did, I think, about 2 years ago on the topic of Constantine. We did it on this very platform. I think it was a great, great, great program. Look that up first, hear that. And on that vein, no, they didn't. Because we can, first off, going right back to the I've heard so many times that the image of ISIS and that was pretty much the Christians later on would come along and they would copy that. We've got to realize that the imagery of Mary with a baby Jesus may be similar to other art, but in and of itself, the oldest image of Mary with a baby Jesus, the oldest one, predates the image of ISIS with her baby. And let me just add one more thing. None of these pagans had a virgin born son of God. And so there really is a huge disconnect there, where people try to do what Justin Martyr says. They try to basically reappropriate something that really wasn't for the time period. For instance, Justin Martyr argues that the pagans were the ones copying the Christians. And really, as we go on and on in time, we can see, as time has gone on and we've been able to date the oldest images, but we can see that Justin Martyr had a really good point. A really, really good point. And even if we look at what the great, and this is an Orthodox bishop, the great Bishop Photius, even if we look at what he says, he will lend to the historical truth that there really is no good evidence in terms of arguing that the Christians ate the pagans. Really, it's really the other way around. We can see that paganism copied a lot from what they viewed as pretty much the emerging faith in Christianity. So I think that they would be quite the opposite. I don't think images were copied from paganism. Images were prevalent in paganism. Let us not pretend to not know this. They were prevalent in paganism. But again, just because something was prevalent in paganism doesn't in turn mean that the faith adopted and copied it. Rather, they were prevalent in paganism because they worshipped them as idols. The Christians don't believe their images are idols. They don't believe they're gods at all. So I think there is that huge, huge difference.
If I could interject there, for example, I'm here sitting at a table, and I think that this is the bottom line when it comes to God's condemnation of idolatry. If I called this table Harold, okay, and I said, Harold, I animated this table with the name Harold, and I said, Harold, you are my God. And I prayed to Harold, and I bowed to Harold, then I would be committing the act of idolatry. The table would now be manifested as my God, as Harold.
Yes.
And I think that's the delineation, for example, that Dr. Hussein gave a really, really great explanation for the Kaaba. And I think this is what I mean by sometimes we're all saying the same things in different ways. And so a Muslim would not view their act as a act of idolatry by bowing to the Kaaba. A Lutheran, when I was a Lutheran, we would prostrate ourselves to the cross, actually started the practice in our church when I was our associate pastor in the Lutheran church of genuflecting or prostrating ourselves to the communion wafer, because wafer represented God manifest his presence in a special kind of way. I want to read one scripture here, and I think that this really encapsulates everything. And this is from the Bible, and it's Paul writing about idolatry, actually, and about wood and stone and it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 8. And I'm just going to read real quick. It's verses 4 through 6. And he's actually encountering Christians or who have bought or purchased food from a meat market where the food was, the meat was actually part of a sacrifice in a pagan temple. And so some of the Christians are saying you shouldn't buy that meat. It was sacrificed to an idol in a pagan temple. This, you know, you're participating in idolatry by purchasing this meat to eat because it was sacrificed. And he says this, now concerning the eating of foods offered to idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world and that there is no God but one. For even though there are those who are called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, just that there are many gods and many lords, there is actually to us one God, the Father, of whom all things are, and we for him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, whom all things are and are, and we through him. Now, he talks about the conscience of some of these Christians being affected by other Christians who had no problem purchasing this meat that was sacrificed to idols to eat.
Yes.
Because, you know, he's saying, you know, these Christians who actually, he calls them, you know, stronger Christians, the ones who are actually offended by that, he called them weak. But
yes,
those who had a stronger conscience, who understood that an idol is just wood and stone and there's nothing to it. It's not, there's no real spirit behind wood and stone. And that we're not participating in false worship by buying meat offered to an idol or offered for sacrifice. He understood that, you know, those ones actually understood who God was and that this meat was not an offense to them because they knew the idol is just wood and stone. And I think that's something to really keep in mind for early Christianity and Judaism, is that the reason why the ancient temples have, for example, the Ark of the Covenant had a, on the top of the Ark, what they call a mercy seat, had depictions of what they believe seraphim or cherubim would look like. It was actually two winged serpents facing each other. And so here's
yes.
this image on the Ark where the Ten Commandments was placed in, where God's presence would manifest himself over this Ark. And I'm not sure if in the Quran it speaks of God's manifestation as it does in the Old Testament Jewish Bible. But I think the point is that images were part and parcel of Old Testament worship, and there was not viewed as idolatry to make an image. It was only an idolatry to make an image, to worship the image as an image, like in Aaron's case. He made the golden calf. And I think the idolatry of the golden calf was, of course, is that the Jews, when they came out of Egypt, said that the calf was the God of Israel. So
yes.
they were actually calling the calf God, and the calf was
yes,
just...
Yes, that's true, yes.
So the act of idolatry is actually calling an item the true God when it is not the true God, and then worshiping the item as if it is the true God. And I think that's...
I agree with you. I mean, the Quran also presents the story of the golden calf in that very similar way, that
yes.
they took it as a god, and that's what's being condemned. However, as I said continuously, that religion is there to guide us. It is also to prevent us falling into traps, into temptations
yeah.
of the devil, and into going down the slippery road. Can I just say, I have to apologize. I have to leave because I've got a night vigil starting soon, and I have to be really off now. So, Williams, once again, thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity. And we'll talk again in future. And thank you very much for hosting us as well. And all your listeners. As you can hear, a lot of noise in the background. These are my grandchildren that just arrived, and oh, and also okay. I've got a nice video to go to. So I thank you
I knew
very
it was somebody's
much.
Children.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
All right.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
All right.
Well, we only have 14 minutes left. Actually, I'll say we'll have 10 minutes. Because I actually have to introduce next week's episode. We're going to have a retelecast of Dr. Daniel Wallace, and then the week after I'm going to do a Facebook live event and go through 10 passages of the New World Translation, which I find abysmal in its translation
oh,
and
wow.
its bias. So it's my top 10 worst translational biases or mistranslations of the Jehovah's Witness translation. But and then we will have Carrie Anderson the week afterward, and her Mormon lineage goes all the way back to the very roots of Mormonism, right to Joseph Smith's feet with the first vision.
Wow.
Wow. But I do want me and William to have this as a broadcast, because one of the things that I'm going to be doing a series on YouTube is misunderstandings that evangelicals have of Catholics,
yeah,
and also of some Catholics have of evangelicals, but it's mostly I think that there is a huge misunderstanding of Christianity pre the Reformation, and I think that there is a form of almost like an alien form of Christianity that exists today, and that we forego. All the time I hear is that the Catholic Church is a cult, and that's absolutely I can't believe that, because then I would have to discount 1500 years of Christianity. Christianity did not begin, you know, with John Wycliffe. You know, it did not begin with Wycliffe.
That's correct.
So, I mean, there are a lot of great
That's
Catholics,
correct.
By the way. And all the reformers were Catholics, all of them. So,
that's correct, yes. Luther didn't believe that he had left and made his own religion.
Yeah, I mean,
he didn't believe that.
This myth that Catholicism is a cult, because first of all, you can't be a cult if you're not the break-off. The break-off has to be
exactly. Yes, that's very,
if you're
very
the original.
True. Yes,
if you're the original, you can't be the cult. And
yes,
I
think that's such a great example you make, because just think about what Dr. Hussein said, that there is such huge misunderstanding even on the part of Islam, for really not understanding some of the earliest arguments made by the reformers. So there is a big misunderstanding there.
I hate to say it, but Dr. Hussein's arguments sounded very much like an evangelical.
They did,
scripture
yes,
alone,
that's correct.
You know, only by the Bible. And and the fact is that the Bible has a context, and we're either going to impose our interpretation into the scripture, or we're going to derive the interpretation of the scripture. And how do we derive the interpretation of the scripture? Well, we have to listen to ancient voices and how it interpreted
yes.
the scripture. And so
that is very correct. They're very important.
Yeah. Not to say that interpretation is infallible, but it gives us the context
correct.
To what the Bible is saying. So
absolutely.
Often Protestants lose the context when they lose. I think God provides all of these things as a test. He gives us history. He gives us the church. And he gives us scripture. And scripture is not, scripture interprets itself, but the test that how it interprets itself is that we are not on the fringe when we make our interpretation. So is our interpretation.
That's correct.
A linear of what history shows, and or is it a distraction or a devoid from what history has shown, how Christians have always viewed scripture? and that also involves Judaism, and which you pointed out, Josephus. You know, you know, the Christian, if they want to understand how ancient Jews viewed the Old Testament text, well, you got to go to a Jew.
Exactly. Yeah, that's correct. You got to go to a Jew. Yep.
So that's why Josephus is a really critical element in Old Testament text, understanding, or at least Old Testament Jewish views.
Yeah.
And he has his biases also, but his biases as far as the character of his own people, not so much the interpretation of text. But I just want to just last call for, was it the last altar call? 347-934-0379. Press one if you have a question or comment, and I'm just going to let William, if he has any last words that he wants to share, he can go ahead and share those last words. I don't see anybody pressing
one.
I truly
respect Dr. Hussein a lot, and I the one thing that really really gets me and really I guess sticks out the most is that I mean, we have so much evidence. I mean, in my opening statement, I read what Exodus says. I read what Chronicles say. I mean, we've got so much evidence as to how what was viewed as idolatry, as you mentioned it, particularly what Aaron says, you know, that should really stick out to us. What is being said here? I mean, their God, you know, they gave credit. And this is, you know, Gus, is just so blasphemous, giving credit to an idol for taking them out of Egypt. So really, these have become idols, and that is the heart of idolatry right then and there.
Yeah.
Giving credit to a calf. I mean, that's crazy.
You know, we did a podcast a long, long time ago, me, you, and David. And I think that was a landmark podcast in understanding Orthodoxy and Catholicism, and we covered the veneration of Mary and the saints. We covered some of this right here, and I remember I was at a Baptist church across from a Kingdom Hall when we did the podcast.
Wow!
And I was outside. It was a Baptist convention or something like that, But we covered so much territory, and I thought that it was really, really fruitful in dispelling some really misnomers that so many evangelicals and Protestants have about Catholicism. And I think that the reason why it was frustrating is because Dr. Hussein was actually mimicking many of the same mistakes that evangelicals and Protestants make in their rush to judgment, and yet, you know, hypocritically, sometimes we do the same things in different ways and don't see that that very accusation comes against us. For example, and we have 6 minutes left. I'll say this in that podcast. I remember people talking about prayers to the saints. We talked about prayers to the saints. And I talked about how evangelicals criticize Catholics for their view on prayers to the saints and call it necromancy. Yet, at the same time, the same evangelicals and Protestants will have an urn of their relative or a picture, and they will talk to the picture like their relative is right there. They have an urn with their relative's ashes, and they will talk as if their relative is right there in the room, and actually talk to the ashes of their relative like they were right there with them. And so
that's correct.
Yeah, here is an example of Protestants really hypocritically making an accusation against Catholics, and yet mimicking the same type of things within their own practice, even though it's not a dogmatic practice, but we find Protestants and evangelicals doing that.
That's correct.
And
that is very common. That's correct.
Yeah, very common. And so in this case, the accusation of veneration of images, I just was like, how can a Muslim make that accusation when they go pilgrimage at least once in their life to Mecca, go walk around seven times around the Kaaba, and have to pray facing the Kaaba seven times? So
yes,
many people were mistaking that as an act of worship to what I think may be a stone in a huge black cube, a tented cube, I think.
Yes, that's true.
The fact, yeah, so, I mean, so I would say, what's all the hullabaloo about?
Yes, exactly. Exactly. That's acceptable, but this other form is not. There's really got to be a bit of a connect there, but instead there's a disconnect. And really, as we can see, that disconnect just doesn't seem logical.
Well, I think the disconnect is, first of all, is not really having a context. And once you understand that, for example, what he said himself, Christians use fish as a symbol. They have cross.
Yes.
I mean, I thought that was a self-defeating argument. When you realize that these symbols are used in Christianity, there were symbols in the Old Testament text, and they weren't viewed as ugly or disdainful. They were symbols which Paul says, I boast only in the cross of Christ, Galatians chapter 6, I think, verse 4. And the cross was viewed so beautiful that the archaeological evidence proves that they had crosses in their homes. In fact, in Pompeii, and when Vesuvius blew, the archaeological evidence proves that these were church homes. And the reason why archaeologists found out that these were church homes was because the cross wasn't just in every room. It was in a special room. It was almost like it was in the center of the room, and it was clearly that this was the room where they all would come together to worship. Just like the cross would be, behind the priest as in the sanctuary, behind the pulpit. So it's those same images. And so just putting the things together, you realize, well, there's something more to this, and I have to really rethink these things. And so I know that's what happened with me. I had to rethink these things and realize that I was kind of imposing something that was just it's like Trump derangement syndrome, except it was Catholic derangement. Catholic derangement syndrome.
Yep. And we really see a lot of that Trump derangement syndrome, don't we?
Yes. And the Catholic Church is the whipping boy for everybody. Everybody loves to hate on the Catholic Church. And every church has its share of problems, but really understanding Catholics and where they're coming from, I think, is important, and realizing that they're not imposing something evil, that there's a reason behind what they're doing. And so there is a biblicalness behind the tradition, and I think that's something we need to discuss.
Yes.
This is the last minute, and so we're about to go. I just want to thank everybody for coming and listening. Thank William. Thank Dr. Hussein. And this is definitely going to be a future podcast that needs to be redone, I think. And I will be doing a YouTube series on understanding Catholicism. So God bless everyone. Have a great weekend next week. Oh, Tuesday, Melissa has at 7 o'clock Eastern Time. Listen to her at 7 o'clock Eastern Time here on Healing X Outreach. She has her podcast every second and fourth Tuesday. So you all have a great weekend. Bye-bye.